there's no real point in climbing. I mean, what you've got is a cliff. And what climbers are really doing is trying to find the hardest way they can up it. And once they find up they can climb it this particularly hard way, they'll look for an even harder way to get up this piece of rock that they can actually walk around in about 5 minutes. With cavers, I mean, we use ropes to make it as easy and safe as possible. People are always making analogies with climbing and caving, as though the two had something in common. In fact, the only common thing they've got between them is that they both use rope. In the case of a rock climber, I mean, you're looking at somebody that's scratching his way up the rock face with his fingernails. The rope's there just in case he falls off. Caves are no place to be messing around, you know, fiddling with finger holes and things. I mean, cavers rig the rope and they slide down it and they climb back up it. For instance, I mean, if a caver came to a drop and it had a builder's ladder leaning up against it, I mean, a caver would be perfectly happy to climb up this. In fact, he'd be pleased that it was there. A climber would be horrified at the same situation.
What we've got here is a single rope technique harness, a sit harness. It's very, very different from the climbing harness, where climbers have two leg loops with a belt which tows the leg loops up in case they fall. With the caving harness, it's designed for the caver to wear all the time and actually be sitting in the harness. It's very, very comfortable. Just stick it on, I'll show you what I mean. Heave it round. Right, rather than a belt and leg loops, which has a two-way pull on it, caving harness has a three-way pull on it. Each side of the harness, and also where we're going to either put our ascenders or descenders. We cannot use a carabiner, because a carabiner will only take a two-directional pull. So we need something that will take a three-way directional pull. And this is what we've got. It's a male rapide. It's almost like a chain link. The advantage of it is the same as the disadvantage of it, as it doesn't undo very easily, which is great when you're halfway down a 300-foot pitch. It's like El Plementos, and you know you're really, really safe. On this, we're going to put an array of other sorts of bits and bobs to get me up and down the rope. What we've got here, we've nicked from the climbing world, and this is dynamic climbing rope. And we use this because we use it in a shock loading situation, and it means that if I rattle off up a pitch, the first thing I want to do is make sure I'm safe. I'm not going to go back down the pitch without using the rope. So this one goes straight into this delta. Okay, that then can be clipped up with two snap gate carabiners so you can whiz them in and out quite quickly. It's like a quick draw release, yeah? You want to be able to snap your carabiners in and then whip them out again. Right, they go out the way, so I'm not going to trip over them and break my neck. Next bit of gear we got is that little baby. It's an ascender. It's called a crawl, and it's shaped to fit the body. Some people call it a chest ascender, but it's actually down here. It's a belly button ascender, sort of just above the naughty bits. And we use two of these to get up. Much safer than going down a rope where you've got one piece of kit which moves and slides around. Right, other things we can add to it is the second. That's the foot loop. And that foot loop, each time I stand on the foot loop, I then tow up the body jammer, which locks, I can sit down, relax, and push it up. Very relaxing, very, very safe, and the caver can actually rest whenever he or she wants to. That's attached by another Mayon Rapide, which is a safety link. Again, it won't come undone. I'll slip that underneath, and I'll screw the whole lot up. Screw, screw, screw. There we go. That's nicely locked out of the way, and I can actually use that as a spanner just to tweak it up, get it nice and tight. Okay, now that thing will just flop, okay? So I need something to put on it to keep it upright. Not necessarily load-bearing, but something that will keep me towards the rope. So we've got this. And this is just a simple strap. It's sort of an 8-foot strap, which I'm going to wrap around in a ring around my body. Left shoulder under my right armpit. And by jumbling it at the neck and the sides, I can pull it down. It's nice and tight. And if it's in the right position, when I get off the rope, I'll actually be stoop walking like that. Okay, so that's how we get up and down the rope. Ascenders. That's the same sort of thing as that, really, but it's a different shape. And we attach it with a carabiner. And we're using 8mm static rope there. I can pop that into the teeth and clip it up out of the way. It's nicely safe. Last thing, it's probably the most dangerous bit of kit. This is a descender. Much more care is needed descending the rope than ascending one. With ascenders, you've got two bits of kit which slowly slid up the rope and attach themselves quite nicely. With a descender, it's one piece of kit and it slides. Descenders are very important things for going down ropes. You've got to get them right. Doesn't matter how much millions of pounds of spent on gizmetry to try and get you down the rope. If you let go of it, there's a good chance you're going to plummet. It's not a good idea. It's not good for business. Right. This descender is called a Petzl stop. And the danger is if you use the handle to descend with, it doesn't like it. And also, if you let go of it, it's designed to stop you. Okay? But what can happen, that can get caught in the chest harness or in your arm. Catch it. Death. Imminent. So, it's technique. That's what makes you go up and down the rope, not that. That's a dead man's handle. Yeah? It's full in and you shouldn't go anywhere. You use technique to get you down the rope, you let go, and then to stop. But it's all done with the right hand.
Here we have the ascender. This is to go back up the rope, having descended to the bottom. As you can see, there's a cam here which fits the ascender onto the rope with downward pointing teeth, so that the action is such that as you push up, it runs freely. As you pull down, it locks onto the rope.
Like so. The way it works is like a puppet on a string. Push this one up and pull that one down. See how they lock? Sliding it up. Doesn't take any effort at all. And you can relax, and if your harness is adjusted right, you'll be quite comfortable and you can hang around for quite a while. And you can have a rest. Unlike the old lad on Lifeline days, where communication was a problem, you used to have to shout up and say, "I'm going to have a rest there, Brian. You are. I'm having a rest." Plementos, bottom of the pitch. What I'm now going to do is rattle off up to the top of here, do a quick change of it, and show you how to put it into practice. Bye.
We're walking in the air. We're floating in the moonlit sky. The people far below are sleeping as we fly. I'm holding very tight.
Cavers in general have a better attitude and make better rope access workers than climbers. Climbers come from the point of view that they're going to use their own skill in order to ascend a piece of rock or a mountain, and therefore they tend to use equipment as a backup in case anything should go wrong. So they're into the fall arrest business. The essence of rope access work is that it's work positioning in a hazardous environment where you use your equipment to ensure that a fall is not possible. So we're not dealing with fall arrest, we're dealing with fall prevention.
SRT is generally a very safe technique, providing that we're careful about where we fix the rope. Now, if the rope rubs on the side of the rock, if it abrades, bing, splat. So we've developed techniques to enable us to fix the rope safely, particularly using bolts and rock anchors. And again, we've borrowed from industry the techniques of drilling. And we'll place some quite sophisticated rock anchors, which enable us to fix the rope at the top of a shaft and then refix it part of the way down in order to avoid rub points. So it's been really nice for me over the years to play a part in the development of these types of techniques and to see the techniques that we've used underground use stuff which has been developed by industry. And then all those techniques have been borrowed back again by industry for rope access work. So I've got loads of mates now who earn a living by doing this up and down skyscrapers, cleaning the bits of skyscrapers that the architects didn't design a system to reach. And long may the architects continue to do it, because they keep people like us in business. And you find rope access people hanging above glass atriums in buildings all over the country, or sticking bits of concrete back on the outside of buildings, because it would cost a fortune to scaffold them. I mean, all these techniques are used in the North Sea for emergency escape purposes. You know, if there's a fire in a North Sea oil rig, the guys just go clip, jump over the side.
Caves are small and tortuous places, and the techniques that are suited to those are suited to other tortuous places. I mean, the nests of pipework that you find in some oil refineries, for instance. And one particular place I've been working quite a bit is in nuclear power stations. Rather than having firemen running all over the place and squirting nuclear reactors with hose pipes, they tend to have their own trained SWAT teams, if you like, that can zoom in and do their own rescuing.
I was lucky because at an early age I got into some adventurous sports, canoeing and sailing, and towards the end of my schooling I discovered caving. As soon as I'd felt my first bit of virgin passage, I was hooked on exploration. I knew that I wanted to go places that other people hadn't been before, and it was a little bit haphazard to begin with. You know, we had one cylinder and one valve, and we'd swim off into these dark, murky passages and have minor epics, or what we thought were epics back then, scare us to death. You probably couldn't get a commercial diver and employ him to do what a cave diver will do. Money's not the motivation, it's that unknown environment, it's that dark tunnel that no one's ever been down. It's utilising what industry has developed and then taking it and modifying it and adapting it to your own needs. And that's where the rebreather has come in. The problem with open circuit is that if you had a cylinder that would last you 90 minutes on the surface, if you took it down to, say, roughly 200 feet, 60 metres underwater, it would last you 10 minutes because of the partial pressure, the ambient pressure of water down there. And that's a lot of wasted gas. You take one breath in, a lot of oxygen goes away. You've only metabolised 4% of what you've taken on board. So with a rebreather, what you do is you take a breath of gas, you metabolise your 4%, you create your CO2, that comes around and gets scrubbed. The 4% gets replaced from a small cylinder, and a small cylinder might last you anywhere up to 8 hours. And that's any given depth, because you only metabolise the same amount of oxygen on the surface as you would at 200 feet. It's not depth dependent. The thing that cave divers like doing is exploring remote sumps, you know, places where most people would be having amazing nightmares. You know, it's dark, it's claustrophobic, it's full of water, you know, that's that fear of drowning. And cave divers like to take this technology and push to the absolute limit, take the technology right up to the edge and then bring it back again.